Bonsoir. How are you, dear friends? We are building the most inspiring and phenomenal communities of wine lovers. As we all know, wine is the catalyst of the greatest discussion. We'll be talking wine, but of course food, and everything that touches all our nation and senses. Bonjour, bonsoir, dear friends, and welcome to JCB Live. This is another extraordinaire historical moment in life. We're going to be interviewing and spending the next moment together with one of the most amazing men in the history of publishing in America. His name is Josh Green. It's a beautiful beard, a very sensual voice, and he's a brain. Obviously, he graduated from one of the best universities in the United States, Princeton. I stutter when I say it because I would not even apply to it because I would never, ever get accepted. It's too much of an intellectual world. We became friends over two decades ago because George started, after a long life in great magazine publishing, Wine and Spirit magazine. He was really the man behind it. He's been drinking wine since the age of 13. He has a very strong opinion about the 100-point rating, which I'm very excited we'll be talking about. He publishes one of the best restaurant polls of all time, so big question during this pandemic. And I really believe, and dear friends, you will notice for yourself, he's one of the most interesting men in the world of wine. He's a big Francophile. He loves Europe. He loves all the continent at large. I'm very pleased, dear friends, to welcome with Buena Vista, the victory, the history of champagne, Mr. Josh Green himself. Josh. I know bubble makes you come alive much faster. So, Josh, it is a great pleasure to welcome you to our wonderful live session. So, Josh, you got to open the bottles with me now.
I've got it right here.
Cheers.
Great to see you, John Charles. Thank you so much for that great introduction.
Well, and it's all true. You know,
I've never had your champagne before, Jean Charles.
What do you think of
it? I haven't even tasted it yet. It's a beautiful color. It's very golden.
Are you spitting the wine I give you with pleasure, harmony, and friendship? Did I really see what I saw?
I am. You know why? Because I've tasted 30 champagnes this morning and 30 vintage ports this afternoon. And if you want me to not be drooling and slobbering on your show, then I have to spit.
Well, so Josh, you are an expert at so many things. Give us, maybe let's dive right in because you're an expert in bubbles. This is one of your favorite drink of
champagne,
all.
Champagne for me is heaven. Absolutely.
So how was your tasting today? Do you do it indoor or outdoor?
We did it outdoors. Since the pandemic, we have been not doing any tastings indoors at all. Because, wow. You know, the whole concept of expectorating and then spreading your, you know, like if you are in a chorus and you sing and you express all of your voice, it's the worst possible thing for COVID. And I think that spitting is probably worse than that. So outdoors, it's fine. And I've been holding tastings out by my pond at my house. And today was the first day that I tasted, that we did tastings at my friend's restaurant, which he just closed for the season. Yeah, up here in the Berkshires, things close at Labor Day, or he usually closes at Thanksgiving. But because of this season, he closed at Labor Day. It's called the Dreamway Lodge, and he has a very beautiful property. So we were outdoors tasting champagne by his hydrangeas and all of the trees. And it was beautiful. It was absolutely beautiful.
So what, tell us about doing a champagne tasting. What does it entitle? And what was the big takeaway today of your tastings?
Well, the way that we do it is we do it by house. So we taste each house on its own, so that if a house does a lot of dosage and the wines are sweet, they don't affect the wines that are dry. And so we basically sort of put some of the richer wines, fuller bodied, sweeter styles up front. And then we put the drier styles, more savory and more intensely flavored at the end. And the last two flights were absolutely beautiful. I don't know what they are yet because it's all blind, but, the last two flights, everyone went nuts over. There were six of us tasting, and they were enthralled by these wines. So a lot of it had to do with the fact that we were outside.
Yes.
With oxygen. The oxygen makes a huge difference.
Well,
tasting with oxygen makes a huge difference.
No, I fully agree with you. So tell us more about that, because I really believe a lot of people think they should always formally be indoor and they're gonna not have very high-end wines or very unique wines outside. So explain us why we should.
Well, you know, we've never done our tastings outside. So only for the last 4 or 5 months have we done our tastings outside. And it has been kind of a revelation that different wines show well outside.
Yeah.
And I haven't yet figured out which are the wines that show better outside than the other ones, but there's no question a difference. And I believe a lot of it has to do with just the richness of the air interacting with the wine. You know, when you taste in someone's cellar, it's moist and humid and there's oxygen. And so the wines, if you taste in a Burgundy cellar where you're from, the wines are always tasting better in a Burgundy cellar. There's no question. They're always beautiful in a Burgundy cellar. And it's because there's oxygen and there's moisture. And when you go outside, or when you go into a very deracinated office space, there's no oxygen, or there is oxygen. There's less oxygen and there's less moisture and it's more technical. The wines taste more technical. And outside or in a cellar, they taste more beautiful.
Well, it's a great advice. I love it. So now you are inside. What do you think of La Victoire? Because, you know, we made this wine, Josh, and thank you so much for giving us a few words in a moment on it. This is called Victory or La Victoire because it's meant to really represent the victory of Buena Vista, being the first one to produce a méthode champenoise in the history of California, you know, in 1861, as you know, because you love the history and you're a big history buff yourself.
I did not know that Buena Vista made a sparkling wine in 1861. So that's interesting to me.
Yeah, the first one. And the champagne people authorized us to actually do a champagne named Buena Vista, because normally you're not allowed, as you know. Mm-hmm. If it starts in the U.S., you cannot do, or vice versa. Mm-hmm. Or from any country, the brand has champagne.
So Jean-Charles, where is this wine from? Where in Champagne is this wine
from? Ah, this is a very unique area. I'm going to let you guess. You are the experts.
I find it very rich and very toasty and very, very beautifully full-bodied.
So Josh, you believe in a very unique ranking system. Why don't you tell us about your belief on how you rank wine from the 100 points to the 5 stars to the way you do it?
Well, it's not so much unique because a lot of people are using the 100-point scale, but we use the 100-point scale differently from other people because we basically recommend wines. We don't rate wines, we recommend them. So we have panels that meet, and so today we had 5 people on a panel outside tasting wines, and we go around and we ask them whether you would tell a friend to buy this wine or not, which is different from rating the wine. So they decide whether the wine will get recommended, and then when they've decided their wine will get recommended, then we have five different critics, and they all cover different regions of the world. And they're usually tasting with these panels. Almost always they're tasting with the panels. And they will then decide what score to give the wine. And so our scoring system is in effect different, because it's based on a recommendation rather than a absolute quality rating.
I like this a lot. It's very, but now tell us, you know, we have so many friends with us tonight, mm-hmm. who want to get in your brain.
Okay.
I mean, I've always wanted to get in your brain for two decades. Luckily, I could penetrate it once in a while, which makes me sometimes a little more clever than I am when I'm with you. Tell us how you look at wine. Give us a quick Josh Green tutorial about how you evaluate a wine, because give this advice to all of us.
We train our critics to think about wine in terms of where it grows and how it grows.
Okay.
So we try to look at wine based on what we believe is the viticultural aspect of the wine, the environmental aspect of the wine, rather than the human work on the wine. So humans work on the wine to grow it, and that's something we see as positive. Humans working on the wine to fashion it, we're less interested in.
Okay.
And so, you know, I mean, you spend a lot of time with your vineyards working in biodynamics, which is something that we have a lot of respect for. And
thank you.
We believe that farming is what creates real wine. And whether people can perceive that or not,
yes.
We don't know. We think that we can perceive it. And generally, the wines that we recommend are wines that are well-farmed. When we go back and look at what we've recommended, most of them are very well-farmed wines, whether they're organically farmed, biodynamically farmed, ROC, you know, I mean, this new ROC credential, which is very interesting to me. There are aspects of farming that show up in the wine. And I think when we can taste that, that to me is, that's why I'm in this business, because I think that it's really important that farmers work the land in a valuable way. And so when we can value that, when we can taste that, I think that's amazing. And I think that's great. And so that's really what we're looking for.
And you know, it's music to my ear and you're making me vibrate of excitement. But how do you, and I, you know, we share so much of that together. How do you taste the farm? How do you taste the vineyards? Explain to all our friends watching, some are in the wine world, some are not, what you taste in there.
Because when you taste a wine that is completely stripped naked of all of the winemaking tools, of the wood, of the, you know, like, there are some producers in Burgundy now that are using clay pots rather than wood.
Which we are, of course.
Yeah, yeah, and it's becoming a trend in Burgundy. And some of them who I've spoken to say that it diminishes the reduction in the wine.
Yes.
That when they fermented their wine and aged it in wood, that it had a reductive character that was less interesting to them than when they fermented the wine and then aged it in clay pots. And it was able to work through the fermentation and the aging in a way that was not reductive, that had more oxygen coming into the wine and was opening the characteristics of the wine in a more interesting way, so that the wine isn't dressed up in these fashion statements of oak. Instead, it is clearly stripped down to the flavors of the grapes that are coming from the vineyard. So how do you taste that?
Yes.
That's
it's
really
so well explained, but how do I feel it in my mouth, on my tongue, in my nose? How does my body respond to this?
I think our bodies naturally respond to it, and that are tempted by sugar, by oak, you know, which is also another form of sugar. Mm-hmm. We're tempted by these winemaking tools that seem to make the wine more attractive.
Yes.
But when you strip the wine down and it's coming from a really fantastic place and it's a really good vintage, there's no question that the emotion that it creates in your, you know, part of it is that if you just taste the wine, you don't think about it, you just taste the wine and it tastes really, really good to you and excites you, and it, you feel the energy of the wine, you feel the dynamism of the wine, you feel the excitement of the wine. There's no question that it's a well-grown wine. If you feel the richness of the wine, the weight of the wine, the fullness of the wine, it might be a well-grown wine, but it also might just be a wine that's been manipulated to taste that way. So for me, when I feel energy coming out of the wine, that's something that human beings can only help. They can't create. They can only help sustain it.
And, well said.
You know, and I taste wines that have energy, and I taste wines that are dead. And I taste $100 bottles, $300 bottles, $500 bottles of wine that are dead. Mm-hmm. And I taste $20 bottles, $50 bottles, $600 bottles of wine that are filled with energy.
So Josh, I love this discussion. You gave me goosebumps. I love it because I'm so much like you. So explain to all our friends with us today, what is a wine with energy? What is a wine that is dead?
A wine that is dead is easy to describe because it's flat on your palate. And it can be rich and delicious and full-bodied and fruity. And, you know, but when, what I think about is where the fruit is in its life cycle. So yeah. Is it fresh plum? Is it green plum, underripe plum? Is it fresh plum? Is it purple plum? Is it prune? And is it raisin? You know, is it like way beyond prune? And there are a lot of very expensive wines that are prune or raisin. And to me, they're not going to live very long because they are overripe. And the green plum maybe is a little bit underripe. Maybe it's not quite right yet. But when you hit the freshness, and when you get that, when you get the fruit at the very specific time that it's ripe,
yeah,
the fruit has energy. The fruit sustains the energy that it takes from the plant, that it takes from the ground. And you know, when you, anybody, you don't have to be a brilliant taster to know this. Anybody who tastes a really ripe peach, when it's in August, when it's optimally ripe, it has energy. It has, I mean, it's so delicious, you can't stop eating it until you just have the pit left.
It's very vibrational. I love it. And a wine which is dead is a dead wine, right? It's not inspirational.
No.
So now, Josh, you, and obviously, as of now, everybody loves you. I could see it in the comments. Tell me, how did you get started? Princeton graduate, you're true intellectual. You're a writer, you're about literature. How did you get into wine, and how did you get to start such an influential magazine? Because all our friends listening, many of them have done amazing things. Some of them are asking themselves, maybe I should change what I'm doing. Maybe I should have another path. How did you know it was what you've done, and how did you do it?
Well, at the time, magazines were interesting businesses. And you could make a living off of a magazine back in the 80s. And that was long before the internet. It was long before social media. I got involved with the company that financed magazines. I had been working in restaurants. I'd been working at wine shops. I wasn't necessarily a wine expert, but I thought it was really interesting that this wine magazine came to the company that I was working for that was financing magazines. And it was the last magazine that I sold working for this company. And I thought it was fascinating that a wine magazine could exist. There were There was Vintage Magazine back then. There was Les Amis de Vin. There was no Wine Spectator at the time. Well, there was, but it was a newspaper published in Southern California.
That's right.
Yeah.
So you really were, hey, I'm as you were the pioneer, I'm serving as well the white wine.
Okay.
Talking, the ferment, because it's obviously a pioneer wine as well. But keep going with the story, because I think it's amazing. You know, it did not exist, and you started the trend US of Wine Magazine, which was unheard of at the time.
When I got involved with this magazine, there were basically two other magazines, neither of which exist now. And then 5 years later, I purchased it in 1989. And at that time, Marvin Chankin had really, I think that by then Marvin Chankin had bought Spectator. I think he bought it in the early 80s. And then Adam Strum got involved in publishing Wine Enthusiast. So there were three magazines of a different sort at that point. And we were, at the time, the consumer magazine, and Spectator was the trade magazine. Spectator became the consumer magazine in the 90s, and we became the trade magazine in the 90s. So we sort of flipped sides. We found that working with the trade was much more consistent with our team. So our team came out of restaurants, our team came out of the food business, and they were really interested in how wine and food went together. And that was not so interesting to consumers at the time. Consumers were much more interested at the time, back in the 90s, of, you know, what are you gonna drink before dinner with, you know, what Chardonnay are you gonna drink, what Merlot are you gonna drink? And that wasn't interesting to us. So we moved more toward the trade, which was much more, they were more interested in unusual wines, in wines from unusual places, as well as being interested in wines from a place. So while consumers at that time, I think consumers now are much more interested in wine being tied to a place. In the 90s, they were not so much interested in that. And I hate this word consumers. People who drink wine in this country are more interested in wine being from a place than they were 20 years ago.
That's right. And you were a big part of that influence as well, by really bringing them to the sense of place. So talking about sense of place, we wanted to select a wine for you. You're true entrepreneurs, you're a pioneer in the publishing business of wine and spirits. So not just wine, but spirits as well. This is a ferment all the way from Hungary, where we obviously make it. And this is a wine to your appreciation, so we'd love your comment on it. And then to tell us.
So before I say anything about it, is this where Horasti was from?
That's right.
So is that why you're making this wine?
Yeah, absolutely. Horasti was the founder, as you know, of Buena Vista. Mm-hmm. And you know the story almost better than I do, or maybe better. And we wanted to pay tribute. Indeed, and we wanted to pay tribute to a great variety that many of us don't know that much, ferment. I mean, it's so interesting, it's so exciting, it's crisp and vibrant, and it's not Chardonnay, it's not Sauvignon Blanc, it's not Chenin Blanc.
It's really
not
beautiful.
Pinot Blanc. What do you think?
I think it's delicious. It's rich and fresh, and it has a lot of high tones to it, a lot of floral high tones to it that are beautiful. Wow. It's really, I mean, it's unusual to find dry ferments. There are a few people making them.
Yeah.
But mostly they're used for, most of the grape is used for Tokaji Aju.
That's it.
Yeah.
Which we produce as well.
Oh, you are making Aju. Okay.
Yeah. But now, Josh, it's about you. So where do you see, as an expert in wine, the big future of wine in terms of taste, and how have you seen, you know, the American fantastic wine palates evolve over time? And in many ways, thanks to you and your magazine.
I think the evolution, the biggest transformation from my place of, from where I see, where, from where I sit, has been during the Great Recession. So I think it'll be very interesting to see what happens in our current Great Recession. Because during the last Great Recession in 2008, 2010, 2012, people switched from their concerns about, how do you say it? There was a lot of people, there were a lot of people drinking wines that were fashionable. And in the Great Recession, people started drinking wines that they liked. And they were willing to drink wines that they liked from anywhere. So they were open to tasting wines from Eastern Europe, like this, tasting wines from places in France that they never would have gone to, from Spain, from Portugal. You know, Portugal in the late 2010s, early teens, really got traction in this country because the wines were so good and so inexpensive.
Yeah.
So people were looking for really delicious wines that they could afford. And I think the same thing is happening right now. I hope the same thing is happening right now. I think that because of the internet and the power of the internet, a lot of people are buying very heavily branded wines right now that are less expensive. But there's also an opportunity to buy a lot of really good wine from places that they've never heard of. And I do think that wine drinkers in this country are much more open in the last 10 years than they were 20 or 30 years ago. Open to tasting things like ferment, enjoying it, appreciating it, discovering it, being open to it. Just allowing themselves to let it flow over them and let themselves take it in.
So, yes, well, and you've helped a great deal to let people discover all that within, and thanks to the magazine and your internet sites and so forth. So tell us, in your position, owning a great magazine, again, Wine and Spirits Magazine, having been the founder, the creator, where do you see, Josh, in broader strokes, you're 11 to wine, the evolution of publishing after, you know, the evolution of the 21st century and the unusual time we're in?
Publishing is in a really challenging moment right now, I think, across the board. If you are the only people that I know that are thriving in publishing right now are two or three very big newspapers, the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, and the Atlantic actually got a huge bump recently. And the New Yorker's doing well. Beyond the, you know, in the same way that celebrity culture is very powerful, the very few major publications are doing extremely well. Everyone else is struggling. And the media has been so bashed in the last 4 years that, you know, under a different scenario, we were growing. Our business was really growing until 2016. After 2016, we have struggled and been beaten up always. And I think a lot of publishers feel that way, because the media is suspicious. You know, people are suspicious of the media now. People have called them into question, and it's a really, I've been doing this for years and years and years. This is the most difficult, challenging time I've ever worked in the media. And I think that the media is what creates our democracy, whether it's in wine, whether it's in politics, whether it's in anything. I think the media is crucial to our democracy, and we need to respect it. We need to support it. We need to, how do you say it? We need to honor people who work in the media the way we need to honor people who work in education.
Yes.
And I try to do that personally by subscribing to the Times, by subscribing to the Atlantic, by subscribing to the New Yorker. And there's a lot of, social media is not media. It's social media. It's a different thing. And it's valuable and it's a very powerful tool, but it is not edited. It is, you know, it actually sells itself on the fact that it's not edited. And editing is from, you know, what I do professionally, I'm an editor. I'm a professional writer and a professional editor. And I respect things that are edited. And I look at the New Yorker, and the New Yorker is beautifully edited. I look at the Atlantic, it's beautifully edited. The New York Times, beautifully edited. Washington Post, beautifully edited. And that's it's a profession that is not honored now. And I think it's a shame. I think that that's hugely important. Editing, people would like to be able to just say what they want to say.
Yes.
And that's what social media is about. But, you know, so you sort of, John Charles, you sort of opened up a can of worms by asking me this question.
I love it though. Great discussion. No, but it is intellectually phenomenal. And I agree with you. There's the unedited, the social media, and then obviously this other side, which is amazing that you run. Talking about that,
what is this next one?
Well, we got to get a neutral man, the sheriff.
The sheriff. Okay.
To arbitrage this great discussion between, you know, what you just mentioned, because I think it's amazing. And I agree with you. We need to make sure we have phenomenal independent media to be able to voice their opinion, say their opinion, and, you know, build their opinion. And I think it's so essential. But now, as it's our last one and our last few minutes, I have a very big question for you. First, maybe to discover this wine. Give us your opinion of what you're tasting.
So tell me what this is. I don't know, Sheriff.
So this is an assemblage of 6 different grapes coming from California that really represent the life of the Count of Buena Vista, who became the first sheriff of Southern California, of San Diego, in 1850.
Wow, of San Diego.
Of all places, when he came in first west, that's where he started. So it's 1850, and it's basically Cabernet, Merlot, Petit Syrah, and a few other grape varieties that are really composing this blend. So it's quite amazing. But Josh, I'd love for you, as we have sadly little time left, everybody wants to hear more than the last 40 minutes, but if you had a few big advice for the world, what would they be in today's time, and maybe in relation to wine, food, and the world at large?
Big advice for the world. Wow, that's a big question, John Charles.
Well, I read your editorial, and it's full of good advice, you know, in between your factual outlines.
I guess the way, I mean, I don't know that I can advise anyone, but I think that we all need to be really concerned about how we live on this earth. That's, if you're going to give me free rein to talk about anything, that's what I would talk about.
Absolutely.
And that, I mean, one of the things that I really respect about you and your company is how much you value the way you farm. And one of the reasons that I'm in this business is because I want to promote people who value farming in a sophisticated way that is concerned about how it impacts the world. And all of us, you know, we look at this pandemic, we look at the wildfires that are going on in California, where you are, we look at the hurricanes that are hitting, we look at all of these things that are outcomes, symptoms of climate change, and we don't know how to deal with them. We don't know how to deal with the actual root problem. And that's why I'm very excited about regenerative agriculture, thinking about how humans interact with their environment. And wine is sort of at the center of that point. It's at the, it's where humans meet their environment. And I think that that's when wine becomes an emotional thing, is when the environment and the people meet. And so whether it's a sheriff taking care of that interaction, or whether it's—
We hope not. We hope we don't need him. Or this is, yeah.
Yeah, but it's a, to me, it's something that I value in this business more than anything else.
Yes.
Is the way, and I think that if I were going to advise people about why they should be drinking certain wines versus other wines, support the people who are farming well. Support the people who are growing grapes in a way that's helping the world rather than hurting the world. And it may be that you can find wines that are much more delicious through that. I certainly do. I think that, you know, we can all, you know, I'm an old guy now, and I have to change my diet all the time to get used to my being old. And so you get accustomed to new things, new tastes, new ways of enjoying food. And a lot of people really don't want to get accustomed to changes. But if you allow yourself to get accustomed to changes, and if you allow yourself to get used to the flavor of a wine that's well grown, you can really appreciate it and you can really love it in a way that it's harder to love a wine that is well made. So I think that if people can learn to love wines that are well grown, the earth will be a better place.
Wow. Ooh la la. A lot of phenomenal wise words, as always, Josh. Well, Josh, I want to thank you so much for being with us. Can you believe we've been 40 minutes together and we could be 5 hours?
No, I feel like we just started. It's always so great to talk to you, Jean-Charles.
Hey, Josh, would you promise me we have another session together soon?
Absolutely.
Because I have another 30, 40 questions. And you know what I love is I'm typically the one answering your journalist questions of your people. And I'm so glad to be able to ask you questions. So, Josh, it was so phenomenal to be together today, for you to talk about, you know, your magazine, your history, your beginning, your schooling, your inspiration, your advice to people, the way you rank wine and taste wine, and the way you tasted wine today outside, which is a great idea to let air come in.
Yeah, it makes a huge difference. And Jean-Charles, I really appreciate the way you grow wine and the way you talk about wine. I love how dynamic you are in the way that you talk about wine.
Well, so thank you.
It's really a pleasure to talk with you.
Well, and Josh, we want to have you more to talk about the brains of wine, the minds of wine, the emotions of wine. That would be the topic, because you will be incredible. So, Josh, I want to thank you so much. One, for who you are. Two, for being a friend. And three, very importantly, for doing what you've done for the wine world over the last three decades, because the wine world will never be what it is if the wine world had not met you and you had not contributed what you have to wine. So
thank you so much, Jean-Charles.
Merci beaucoup. And to very soon.
Soon.
Thank you, Josh.
Ciao, ciao.